you to care.
Welcome back to the SMJ Podcast. In episode 4, we'll be taking a listen to one of the most prominent South American beat groups, or should I say shake groups, of the 1960s. The Shakers, or Los Shakers, consisted of Hugo Fattoruso on lead guitar, brother Osvaldo on rhythm guitar, Pelín Capobianco on bass, and Caio Vila on drums. The foursome, whose initial image and sound were heavily modeled after the Beatles, were the forerunners of the Uruguayan invasion, where they gained great fame in Argentina and other territories in the Río de La Plata. They would go on to bring the British invasion sound, and later on, a fusion of Latin jazz pop to the continent. Outside of South America, they still tend to be largely unknown, and if given recognition, are usually smeared as Beatles impersonators. Despite the ignorance of the few, the Shakers' catalog has a creative wealth of original material that can easily stand alongside the greatest music of the era. Although there are no guests on this episode, come shake with me and hear the story of the band that, to paraphrase their biggest hit, broke it all. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Hugo, Osvaldo, Pelín, and Caio, the Shakers. On February 7, 1964, the Beatles arrived at JFK Airport in Flushing, New York, thus officially bringing Beatlemania to the United States. 2 days later, they performed to 73 million viewers on The Ed Sullivan Show, helping further solidify their fame in both the US and Canada. The takeover was swift as hordes of teenagers adopted their mop-top hairstyles and danced away to their recent number one hit, I Wanna Hold Your Hand, and their album Meet the Beatles. Trying to bank off the ignorance of some people, colonies of Beatles phonies and copycats instantly infested the country. The bands generally tried to mimic the Fab Four as close as they could, while their representation, record labels, and concert promoters sometimes went as far as lying to audiences by saying they were the real deal. In the US and UK, this was harder to pull off, however in countries south of the border where Western music had yet to make a big enough impact, it was easier. Pertaining to the eventual formation of the Shakers was a group of West Palm Beach, Florida Beatles impersonators named the American Beatles who actually performed for the Beatles themselves on their first US visit. The quartet, who formed in 1959 as a bar band by the name of the Ardells, consisted of Bill Andy and Tom Condra on guitar, Vic Gray on bass, and Dave Hieronymus on drums, were taken under the advisement of manager Bob Yori, who instructed them to dress like the Beatles and adopt their sound. The group, who instead spelled Beatles just like the insect, was quickly sent on tour, and at one performance in Miami, Rudy Duclos, an impresario from Argentina, happened to be in the audience. Hoping to capture a potential lucrative deal with Yori, the two schemed away as they tried to figure out a way to beat the Beatles to South American audiences, with the target audiences being Brazil, Argentina, and Uruguay. Given the best hype they could be given, South Americans, who had started to become much more aware of current international musical acts, had already started to garner affection for the real deal. Naturally, the coming of what they thought were the real Beatles was met with great enthusiasm. Fortunately, upon arrival in July, Yori and Duclos, along with their phony creation, ended up being stomped out of business by the press and Beatles fans. Despite their eventual extermination from the continent, they did, in an odd way, end up introducing the Beatles' music to a whole new international audience, and during a performance on Uruguayan TV, they inadvertently altered the course of pop music in the continent. One of the viewers was 21-year-old Uruguayan guitarist, bassist, pianist, and accordionist Hugo Fattoruso, who was born on June 29, 1943. His brother, Jorge Osvaldo, was a drummer, bassist, and guitarist who was born on May 12, 1948. The two already had extensive musical training in jazz with a heavy concentration on a genre known as candombe, which centers around African percussive rhythms. In fact, Osvaldo had already appeared at the International Jazz Festival at Mar del Plata in Argentina, as well as with American woodwind player Bud Shank at the Chilean Jazz Festival that same year. Hugo, who was formerly trained in jazz at the Colischer Conservatory of Montevideo, had toured Chile as a bassist in a jazz orchestra, all while under the supervision of his teacher, Paco Manera. In 1959, the two brothers had formed a swingin' Dixieland group called the Hot Blowers. Regardless of their jazz heritage, like most teens and young adults at the time, they were suddenly being immersed in rock and roll. In a 2005 interview with the Argentine edition of Rolling Stone, Hugo recalls, quote, "The first time I listened to the Beatles, I didn't like them. In front of the house, there was a bakery, which is still there. The owner's daughter had traveled to London and returned with the novelty of a simple album by a new group that was killing there. They were the Beatles, of course, and the song was She Loves You. And at first, I didn't like it at all. But after a week, they had already conquered me." Unquote. Osvaldo would later catch the bug by seeing them in their debut film, A Hard Day's Night. Nonetheless, the Fattoruso brothers still continued to play jazz rather than rock and roll. By the time Beatlemania had set in, their live appearances had landed them gigs at the Hot Club in Montevideo. A musical friend of theirs at this time was Juan Roberto Pelín Capobianco. Capobianco, born on April 1, 1944, was a bassist, guitarist, and bandoneon player that had come from a musical family and had many years of conservatory training. The three decided to form a trio with Osvaldo on drums, Hugo on piano, and Pelín on bass, called the Trio Fattoruso. At the same time, another musician handling dates at the club was 20-year-old drummer Carlos Caio Vila, who, just like the others, got his chops from jazz. Vila, born on January 10, 1944, had been performing at the club since he was 15 and had previously performed at the International Jazz Concert at the Sodre with guitarist Charlie Bird. He quickly struck up a friendship with the trio, which led to the four to brainstorm about what kind of group they wanted to start. Common sense would dictate that if you were to get four Uruguayan jazz musicians in a jazz club, they'd come out forming an Uruguayan jazz quartet, yet here the foursome emerged forming an Uruguayan rock and roll quartet, heavily influenced by the British. Surprises aside, the four were visionaries in that they knew this was innovative music their generation would embrace. In order to make their forthcoming sound relatable, the four decided to name themselves after a current dance craze known as the Shake. They also crafted their image by growing Beatle hairstyles and dressing in matching black Edwardian suits, while becoming much more individualized, jovial personalities, as is obligatory for all boy bands. The band toured during the summer of 1964, with their most important dates being at Punta del Este, a popular spa that was frequented by tourists. In early 1965, their burgeoning reputation had been brought to the attention of EMI's Argentine Odeon Pops label as a result of catching the ear of Miguel Lubé, the pianist for the tropical group The Huahuanco. Almost immediately, they hastily signed their contracts, which, according to Hugo in an interview for Colombia's El Espectador in 2020, ended up being incredibly bad, leaving the band with a minuscule amount of royalties in the end. Not only did EMI get co-ownership of the recordings, but so did their manager, Marco Zimet, who would remain the guardian of their image for decades to come. Notoriously bad contracts aside, the group relocated to Buenos Aires and first ventured into Argentina's EMI studios in March to cut covers of the Scottish folk song My Bonnie and Lennon and McCartney's I Wanna Be Your Man, which was first covered by the Rolling Stones in 1963.
One, two, three.
I Wanna Be Your Man originally went unreleased, while My Bonnie would get issued as a B-side the following year. Several recording sessions later in April, the boys would strike gold as they recorded a Fattoruso Brothers original titled Break It All.
We want you to hear. We want you to dance all night long. But when the music
catchy foot-tapping tune was undeniably a future hit, with lyrics that encouraged the listener to shake away, regardless of being with someone or alone. If you're alone. The up-tempo number, which encapsulated the carefree pop sound of the time, acted almost as a theme song that latched on perfectly to their name. Odeon Pops may have thought differently, though. Their first release was a single recorded in May, featuring a rendition of the breezy Del Shannon song Keep Searching. Now all will understand what I've gotta do. Paired with a Fattoruso's original titled Only in Your Eyes. When you're smiling happy, just to know your mind, and I can see only in your eyes, only in your eyes. If I feel lonely, the single was met with open arms as Argentine listeners finally had a home team. That same home team would quickly expand throughout the rest of the Río de La Plata when in July Break It All was finally unleashed. The song skyrocketed to number 9 and became a solidified hit, much like their self-titled debut album issued the following month. The majority of the album was composed by the Fattorusos, with the elected lead singer being Hugo. Instrumentally, their arranging and production skills were expertly capable of formulating simple yet very catchy pop songs ranging from cheery numbers such as What a Love, Long Night, I've never had a girl like you. You said the ball we've been in true. Oh, please try to understand. And I will. And the contemplative for you and me. The group also showed more enthusiasm for the shake dance craze with several other songs about it, such as Everybody Shake. In an interview, Pelín recalled their recording process and working relationship with recording engineer José Soler. Quote, "We always started sessions at 6 p.m. and finished late. We never recorded in the morning. At noon, somebody would say, 'Dude, we have a session today. Do you have any melody? What about you?' Hugo always made up something at the last minute. And off we went to the studio on Cordoba Street. First take was the backing track. If we didn't like it, we'd do it again. We were very professional and knew what we wanted. José Soler was a very patient guy. He took care of all the crazy ideas we had. I remember that, in the beginning, it took more than 2 hours to get the bass sound that we wanted. The same with drums. That's why it was very difficult to do more than a song a day." Unquote. Despite the fact that the album was made for Latin American pop listeners, the band made the bold move of singing all their songs in phonetic English in an attempt to garner an international fanbase. Most Argentine and Uruguayan singers weren't this progressive at the time, as they still sang in their native language. It was a risky move, as it could have cost the Shakers their fans, however it never did. With no time to take in their whirlwind of success, the guys were quickly whisked away on tour throughout the continent, where they played for hundreds, as well as thousands, at theaters, festivals, and on the most popular TV shows of the day. The media, especially in the Río de La Plata, was inundated with the Shakers' image, as it was plastered all over newspapers, TV guides, and music and teen magazines. So always give me tonight. Their thirst for new meteoric success had yet to be satisfied, even after a hectic year came to a close with a historic concert for thousands at Positos Beach in Montevideo. The group then ambitiously set their sights on the North American market, with their eyes predominantly aimed at the land of opportunity itself, the United States. The group eventually got into contact with a small New York-based label called Audio Fidelity, who referred to them as the South American Beatles. I found your love, I never knew, it is no bad, no bad to me, cause I never thought I would again. Since Shakers' recordings had never been released in the country, and the label specialized in releasing stereo recordings, they chose songs from their successful debut album, along with several single exclusives, to re-record. Oh yeah, and I want that, you know she's been forever mine. Leave me alone, don't understand anymore. Hugo, who was stricken with a sore throat during the recording sessions, couldn't sing lead vocals on some of his songs, so the duty was intermittently handed over to Osvaldo, who did just as stellar of a job. Aside from the vocalist change, the songs were made much more up-tempo. The most interesting cut off the record is a faithful cover of the Beatles' Ticket to Ride, sung entirely in Spanish. Ironically, this was done as a US exclusive, and in a peculiar turn of events, it was issued as the single off the album, with the more hit-worthy Break It All, which the album was also titled after, as the B-side. The Break It All album was released in January of 1966, with virtually no notice. We want you to dance, dance all night long, but when the music starts, it would then quickly fade into obscurity, and later on become a collector's item among Shakers fans. Touring the US was another goal of theirs around this time, but after some thought they found it too daunting of a task, considering they couldn't speak fluent English. Accepting defeat, it was then best decided that they'd stick to their already established South American fanbase. Surprisingly, a medium yet to be explored by the group were movies, as they had very much enjoyed the Beatles' first film, A Hard Day's Night. Up until this point in time, they had only made a short film called Arriving Shakers. Even though pop and rock artists in movies were nothing new, there were artists like Elvis Presley and the Beatles who garnered enough of a worldwide audience to have their own movies, while most artists were relegated to making guest appearances in the movies of others. This ended up becoming the case for the Shakers, as they'd make their one and only film debut in A Scala Musical, or Musical Scale. The film, directed by Leo Fleider, is about an entrepreneur portrayed by Osvaldo Miranda, who is looking for young acts to air their music on radio. The foursome within the realm of the movie aren't portrayed as the successful recording act that they were, but instead as a group of comical Coca-Cola factory workers trying to make it as a rock band. They then catch the attention of the entrepreneur, and as a result get to perform two new numbers titled Oh My Friend and Always You.
Oh, my friend, I don't want to hurt you, but you're... Well, don't you know it? She's calling me time after time. Oh, oh, my friend, open your eyes. Don't hurt your heart. I'm trying to take her out of your mind.
Máxima expresión de la juventud del Río de la Plata, ya conocida mundialmente. Aquí están Osvaldo, Hugo, Caio y Pelín. Aquí están los Shakers.
Thinking of what I was going to do, I put on my boots and walk along. Now in this walk I would try to find a place where I hope to be alone. I can remember all.
The songs will get released as a single in June for the time being. The movie, released in July, also featured hordes of other artists of the day, however the Shakers were the most promoted in the ad campaign. As far as developments in music went, 1966 saw a sea change in pop. Songs started to become much more philosophical and introspective as opposed to the usual boy loves girl lyrics from previous years, as artists like the Byrds and the Beatles began to embrace Eastern and folk influences from the likes of Bob Dylan and Ravi Shankar to game-changing results. More thought was also put into the production of an overall album as opposed to recording a batch of disparate songs, with the main goal being selecting two for a single. Like all other American and British musicians, the Shakers embraced this new direction by covering Girl and Michelle, two songs released on the Beatles' 1965 album Rubber Soul, which is sometimes referred to as the group's foray into folk rock.
Michelle, my bell, these are words that go together well, my Michelle.
Their cover of Michelle, released in May, became a number one hit, while 3 months later in August, Girl followed.
A girl. 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 When I think of all the times I've tried so hard to leave her, she will turn to me and start to cry.
Recorded from February to September, their second South American album, Shakers for You, also known as For You, was released in October.
Vamos, Caio.
I am not the only one who looks for you. Never, 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 never been the only one. I have...
Greeting the Listener is Never Never, another number one hit and immediate Shaker standard composed by the Fattorusos. The simple and catchy song, that is arranged as an amalgamation of pop and bossa nova, is an example of the band starting to branch away from their homogenized pop roots.
Kalimbo!
Caio gives a valiant effort as a songwriter with The Child and Me, an introspective ballad about a musician who longs for the innocence of childhood.
When I was writing this, I thought that I was a child. And all the things we did, the tears came to me. And I remember this, and I feel very young.
The song's thoughtful melody perfectly expresses the maturation the group had gone through within the past year, if not a bit of the wear and tear from the grueling excesses of fame. He also gets to flex his drum skills with some intricate chops on Waiting. Another standout song is the proto-psychedelic I Hope You'll Like It, which has a rustic and dusty Old West aura to it, complete with backwards guitar. '67 was a major turning point in music history. The growing hippie movement, drugs, and psychedelia were becoming international trends, changing musical creativity. The biggest feat in music from that year was Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, which was once again courtesy of the Beatles. After 2 years of whirlwind fame, the Shakers' productivity in the studio started to decline. The recordings that they did manage to release that year tended to be covers of American hits. One of these was the Paul Simon and Bruce Woodley song, Red Rubber Ball, which was released in January.
And I think we're gonna be alright. Yet the worst is over now. The morning sun is shining like a red rubber ball.
The song, which was a number two hit in the US the previous year, was performed by The Circle, a group named by John Lennon and the only American act to be managed by the Beatles' manager, Brian Epstein. Another was a top 40 hit written by Chris Kenner called Land of a Thousand Dances. The song originally became a hit in 1965 when recorded by the Mexican-American vocal group Cannibal and the Headhunters. The rest of the year saw the release of some more single exclusives, but other than that, 1967 is the only year where no album ever formulated. Perhaps compensating for no album was a Shakers TV special directed by Rudolfo Corral for Buenos Aires Channel 13 that was presented as part of the Musical Scale program, which was not related to the film of the same name. The special featured interviews as well as promo films of songs from the past 2 years. Undoubtedly, like the entire world, the Shakers were inspired by the masterwork their idols had produced. Yet the closest they got to acknowledging it in musical form was by releasing a single of the Lennon and McCartney dancehall-style ditty, When I'm 64, the only song from Sgt. Pepper's that didn't represent the times.
When I get older, losing my head, many years from now, will you still be sending me a Valentine, birthday greetings, bottle of wine, if a day out.
This is not to say that the band didn't have their own artistic tour de force waiting around the bend. La Conferencia Secreta del Todos Bar, also known as the Secret Todos Bar Conference, is a force to be reckoned with in the history of South American music. Totally erasing the music sensibilities and presentation of the past 4 years, the group remade themselves entirely. The iconic mop-top hairstyles were cut away, and the matching suits were ditched in exchange for neatly trimmed mustaches and psychedelic regalia for a more in-vogue look. The music for the album, which recording began for in late 1967, were no longer simple pop productions that were relegated to just the four of them. It was now expanded to intricately arranged compositions fused with many different styles of music ranging from John Coltrane-inspired jazz, tango, and candombe. This fusion of artistry was given the name Kalimbo by the four and had previously been yelled out by name on Never Never. The group stretched their musical prowess by also playing other instruments. Hugo finally added his prolific accordion skills. Pelín utilized the accordion derivative bandoneon and cello, while Osvaldo doubled on drums, and Caio played more exotic percussion instruments. Helping top the ambitious proportions of the record were string and brass overdubs that were laid over numerous tracks. Much like the self-titled opener to Sgt. Pepper's, the band spared no time showing off their admiration for the British combo, once again by composing their title track nearly identical to Pepper's, complete with applause, sound effects.
Maybe I read it in a story book. Maybe in a picture, they beat the other stage. They were so general with her leather boots, each one with a pocket full of medals. As a man, the president.
The song then crossfades into the sultry My Aunt Clementine.
Today I was born, my mommy told me, a barber you'll be when you're grown. My Aunt Clementine, when she heard me crying, her sister brought me on a smile. But one day on June, I speak to the moon, I told her I didn't agree.
Crossing over to another style, the album's jazziest Latin cut is Candombe. The song, which is named after the style itself, is laden with trippy cowbell, shakers, and congas, guided by the vocals of the genre's most ardent admirer, Hugo. Perfectly showcasing how much they could excel at vocal arrangements is BBB Band, which marches along with a positively upbeat, catchy tempo. The Pine in the Rose is another colorfully jaunty number interwoven with rollicking accordion playing by Hugo, also features sparkling carefree backing vocals. Making surprise appearances are the two-year-old Oh My Friend and Always You from Musical Scale.
Open your eyes.
When the record was completed, perhaps the primary homage to the era is the long-winded title, which is a reference to an American President's Conference from April of 1967, with Toto being the name of the Hot Club's manager. With such a grand bouquet of fresh psychedelic pop fusion, one would expect the album, released in December of 1968, to be met with enthusiastic response and much conversation, however, it depressingly wasn't. Odeon Pops hated it and were disappointed that the group didn't stick to their old sound, and as a result, did very little to promote the record. The only positive reception and notice for the carefully crafted work came unsurprisingly from fans. Even though the Shakers still had a dedicated audience, the quartet, feeling like their creativity was now constricted both individually and as a group, decided to break up. Like most great art, there was salvation decades later, as after much analysis, critics and 60s music aficionados hailed Toto's Bar as being the Sgt. Peppers of Latin America. The early 70s saw a mass exodus of many 60s groups. The most prominent breakup, which occurred in 1970, was that of the Beatles after the release of their album and film, Let It Be. Politically, things were changing too. Uruguay was experiencing military turmoil, leaving a large portion of the music industry and society in general on hold. Still, that did not prevent Caio and Pelín from doing what they did best. Since the Shakers breakup, the two had formed their own band, named Los Inocentes, also known as The Innocents. Members included Ruben Lorenzo Villela on guitar, along with Pelín's twin brothers Hector on keyboards and Carlos on bass and keyboards. Since bands were no longer recording under the guise of the British invasion by 1971, The Innocents took on a much more streamlined rock-pop sound. Eventually, they were fortunate enough to secure a record deal with EMI's Parlophone once relocating to Brazil. There was only one problem, though. Mainstream audiences had never heard of them. The closest bit of fame the group had from the offset was two former members of the mega-successful Shakers. It was because of this a peculiar marketing decision was made. The Innocents decided to call themselves the Shakers, or to put it more precisely, simply Shakers, with Shakers being spelled with an apostrophe S, just like the original group's spelling before their stardom. Interestingly, it was similar to the dynamic applied to the American Beatles back in 1964. Regardless of the name, the new Shakers radiated just as much gusto as the previous lineup on In the Studio Again. La, 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 la. Whether it be the funky For My Friend M, the fuzz guitar drenched Rubber Class, the saucy Latin congas on their rendition of Carole King's It's Too Late, Majestic Strings on The Day I've Got a Friend, the new band makes a powerful case for being just as fresh as the old one. When In the Studio Again was released, a hit was hoped for, however it never occurred. As a result, the first rebirth of the Shakers quickly sank, and shortly after, the group disbanded.
You see this guy?
Shortly after the first lineup's dissolution, Hugo and Osvaldo decided to head back to their roots by recording a jazz album for Odeon Pops titled Hugo and Osvaldo's Bossa Nova. It was released in 1969 and unfortunately garnered even less success than Toto's Bar. Regardless, the musical brotherly bond of the two continued into the 70s. With bassist Ringo Thielman, they formed a jazz fusion act in the United States called OPA after recording with percussionist Erto Morera. The three went on to have an impact on jazz fusion in South America, regardless of their lack of popularity in the US. Their most acclaimed album, released in 1977, is Magic Time. In 1981, the brothers recorded the Shakers tribute album titled A Los Shakers under the name Otro Shakers. With the new addition of Hugo's son Francisco on bass, the trio Fattoruso reformed in the late 90s. They would go on to record several albums as well as tour internationally throughout the 2000s and beyond. After Opa, Hugo would go on to have a prolific solo career as a pianist, accordionist, arranger, and composer, who'd also collaborate with a massive list of musicians, including Abraham Laboriel, Ruben Rada, and Eduardo Mateo. He currently has 351 credits to his name in the All Music Guide, and would go on to win 2 Latin Grammy Awards. In the early 90s, Osvaldo produced an album titled The Disco Kid, which struck a lengthy musical bond with his partner, Uruguayan singer Mariana Ingold. After his Shakers tenure, Pelín went back to playing his favorite instrument, the bandoneon, under the influence of Italian player Astor Piazzolla. In 1990, he switched to playing keyboards, and with his sons on violin and flute, he formed Gruppo Capobianco. Caio would form Face to Face with Lorenzo Viella from the second lineup of the Shakers. They were going to have several hits on the RCA label, including Leave Me Alone and Goodbye My Friend.
Goodbye, my friend.
From the late 70s to early 80s, he went behind the scenes and worked as a producer and studio musician for CBS and Polygram. In the 90s, he became the artistic director for Sony Music in Venezuela. In 2005, 41 years after they formed, Hugo, Osvaldo, Pelín, and Caio reunited for the first and last time, both on tour and in the studio. The tour throughout Uruguay and Argentina, which got negative reviews from critics, featured the band plowing through a superb set list featuring all of their most well-known songs.
When I was writing this, I thought when I was a child, and all the things we did, the tears come to me, and I remember this, and I feel very young. I wish I could play like a child.
Recording resulted in a new album released on Sony BMG called Bonus Tracks. The slick and polished album, recorded in September, holds a distinction from their others in that it's predominantly sung in Spanish. Paraphrasing Osvaldo, Bonus Tracks was a liberating experience to record, since they no longer felt the need to live up to the Beatles. Unfortunately, much like the tour, critics panned it.
Como un reflejo tu luz, que ciega de amor, a quien te mire.
Critics aside, the past decade has not been kind to Shakers fans. On July 29, 2012, Osvaldo lost his battle with cancer at age 64. Following him in death was Pelín, who on March 25, 2015, passed away from congestive heart failure at age 70. And on March 23, 2019, Caio succumbed to cancer at age 75. As the testament of history shows, successful or unsuccessful, their accomplishments have stood the test of time. With fans in tow, carrying the shaker every now and then for their legacy is Hugo, who, even though perplexed by their fame, is still here to record and recant the story of one of the most overlooked gems of the 1960s, Los Shakers. This is Stephen Jones with the SMJ Podcast. Thank you for shaking with me.